Thank you so much, Rick. That was fantastic. We're going to have some Q&A now. If you want to ask a question, please come and line up here in the center aisle so that he can see you. I'm in the frame of the whole podium. I've just a couple of notes that the software product he just mentioned was cut out there a little bit, Rick, but it's called Swarm Ops. I've taken a look at it. It's a really interesting effort there. You can do cool things like have Bitcoin rewards, bounties for participating in certain ways or taking on certain tasks. I've also read that book, 300 pages, Don't Be Daunted. It's a very engaging and fast read that's very, very easy to get through. And we've adopted some of those practices, not all of them, for some of the things that we do with the Free State Project. So without further ado, I will turn it over to some Q&A. We've got about 20 minutes for that, and here we go.
Thank you. Before the first question, let me add one thing to the warm up. What makes that software unique is that it actually makes it easier to push authority to the edges of the organization. Most, you can think of it as fashion software for activists. Think of it as an HR budget, resource management, taking care of all the paperwork. Since I hate paperwork, I automated all of it. That's where it comes from. I really, really don't like paperwork. So there's a philosophy that went into the software though, and that is, if you're picking on, say, a budget, then it makes it a hassle to manage that budget. So it encourages you to push the authority further out into the organization edges. Instead of holding that $10,000 for yourself, or $100,000, or $1,000,000, doesn't matter, then it encourages you by mere workload to split into smaller pieces and delegate those pieces. This again causes authority to be pushed toward the edges of the organization where the most information is, where the most valuable information is. Go ahead.
Thank you. Is the Pirate Party, it appears to be in reforming intellectual property or aiming to reform intellectual property in the digital era. Are they taking any position one way or the other about what here in the United States we call a utility patent for a physical item? And if so, what is that?
The utility patents, this varies a little bit between countries, but in general, we are very skeptical of industrial protectionism, as I prefer to call it. These monopolies, these exclusive rights, are governmentally sanctioned monopolies on that interfere with private property rights. And utility patents in particular are nasty, seeing how if you're filing for one of these government monopolies, you're limited in what I can do with my physical property, even if I have never heard of you or your utility patent. So yes, we're very critical of them, and pirate parties in many countries have started questioning or attacking, if you like, pharma patents and software patents in particular, because if those two fall, the rest of the structure will come into question. Essentially, it's something that should never have survived the transition from guild mercantilism
enterprise.
Thank you. Hi, Rick. Ernest Hancock from Phoenix. We're for Arizona Pirate Party. When you talk about the software, I'm wondering how you're able to push it out to the outside. We're all about not organizing, you know, the revolution, everything. We didn't have any kind of databases like that. Are the people on the outside accessible to everyone? And is this software something that we could put in and play with now? And does everyone get access to everyone? And is there any central hubbing at all? I wanted to get an idea from you how that works.
It is a centralized web-based system, but since we're really, really careful and not say religious about protecting privacy, protecting personal data, then a lot of people can reach the entire organization, but you need to have a good operational reason to see personal data of other people. Say, for example, that you're the leader of Phoenix, then you can see personal data for people of Phoenix. Now, the person responsible for outreach in Phoenix doesn't need to see personal data. They just need to be able to reach the people of Phoenix, so they don't have access to that. And you would not, for example, have access to private data in California. That way, it's very, very compartmentalized in terms of sensitive data.
Who decides that, though? I mean, is that you? Is there a dashboard that you're operating this from?
If you're taking on the role of, well, say for example that you're
there's roles we have to take on.
Leader of the U.S. for a particular movement. Somebody, you have the role of leading Arizona to somebody that will give them access to all the data in Arizona. They assign somebody as leader for Phoenix that you have never heard of, but that's fine. And so that person gets to see the data for Phoenix. You see everybody, the leader for Arizona that you know sees Arizona, the leader for Phoenix sees Phoenix. And that's assigned as people become comfortable with taking on accountability, not so much authority, but accountability. Think of it as a janitorial role for particular geographic areas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lynn Olbricht. I'm the mother of another alleged pirate, Ross Olbricht, who is serving a double life sentence for his role in the Silk Road website. And I just want to thank you for being here, because we're trying to take the Free Ross movement to another level. And it's not only for Ross, it's for a lot of the issues that are very much at stake here with his case and the precedent that will be set. And it's really overwhelming to try to do this, and so you've inspired me, because it's a real David and Goliath fight. Our opponent is not another political party, it's the US federal government, and needless to say, they have a lot more money. So thank you, I really appreciate it. It makes it seem doable, and I'm gonna look into your other material, and you know, is there a way to be in touch with you or people, you know?
Yeah, can you guys, we can share contact details.
Absolutely.
I would love to.
Okay.
And thank you, Lynn, as well, for fighting for liberty. I'm honored.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's become a much bigger fight than just a fight.
Oh, hello. I was wondering, who do you think will achieve freedom first, Sweden or New Hampshire, and why?
Well, there are many black swans there, but Sweden is not gonna go live to be any time soon. It's been run by social democrats basically since 1930, and they have had the time to revise history, saying that Sweden was a very, very dark place, very depressing, very winters were long, and but the Democrats were elected, and then everything just shone up, and that's essentially what people think here. So, no, like we had a break in social from social democratic rule for about 8 years, falling down to only the second highest practice in the world, which is obviously much too libertarian for the current regime, so we're now the most expensive again. So I don't see them going to liberty anytime soon. New Hampshire, though, has a credible proposal for making it happen. And frankly, I love that shit.
Thank you for taking our questions. My name is Keith Ammon. I'm chair of the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance. We do political action here within the state. And I guess my question, I understand the decentralized nature of the swarm, and I've read your book. I was just wondering, with the pirate party, how do the different roles align with a traditional political party? A traditional political party has a chair at the head of the, you know, the global, the geographic, they're organized geographically. You know, we have a state party chair, we have county chairs, we have town and ward chairs. Then they do certain things like door knocking, data collection, all that stuff. How does it work in the decentralized swarm? That's my question.
Yeah. Who says you need a local chair?
I assume that we don't, but how do you organize? There are things that parties do that are effective in getting people out to vote a certain way. So how does the swarm do it?
A lot of people have been organizing political parties on no more, on a very understandable, but still the justification that this is how other people do it. This is how you build a political party. And that's one of the things I question. We did not have local chairs. Frankly, I fought vehemently against it, because the instant you start creating a lot of different legal entities across on all levels and in all vertical silos, then you start infighting. And that's when you start having different interests compete and fight for resources. It may be that this is a requirement for governmental grant, but frankly, I would rather turn down those grants because the loss to cultural agility is not worth it. So there is some amount of overlap, if you like. Recognizability is a better word, I think, from the outside. I mean, media could look at our organization charts and immediately know who to call, which would have been the local chair in a traditional, in a traditionally organized party. But for us, it was called the local leader, and it was a voluntary role within the very loose movement as a whole. So there's a trick to looking like a traditional organization, not operating like one. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Thank you for talking to us, Rick. Many people here in North America are viewing with alarm the immigration from the Middle East into Europe, and especially into Sweden. And I'm curious what your perspective is on the Swedish government subsidizing immigration from other countries and other cultures into Sweden. How do you view all this? What's your take on this?
There are a lot of people critical of the immigrants at this point in Europe. And like you say, some people are looking at Sweden and to some extent Germany as a bad example. However, and I really must say this with emphasis, I cannot and will never criticize somebody for following their profit motive and self-interest. And this is what people do. Setting up an incentive structure that, like you say, incentivizes people to go to Sweden and not have a very bright future, frankly. And to boot, it puts load on the system that wasn't supposed to be there, and it creates all sorts of overload problems in a country that's already spent 50 years running out of other people's money. That's going to create systemic problems. But it is not the individual immigrant's fault. They are following incentives, they are following their profit motive, they are following their self-interest. Just as I am, it is not in my place to ever criticize that.
Good morning or evening, I guess it is for you. When you talked earlier about setting a goal and then simply inviting people to join your well-crafted goal and then watching an organization grow, I wonder if you could speak to how, after doing that, you manage continuing the message promotion so that people elsewhere in the organization actually comprehend what they're joining, and that continues to be, let's say, pure, accurate enough, and simple enough that people can understand, so that out at the fringes, beyond your horizon, you don't have either agent provocateurs or simply confused people or something else.
It's a very good question, but it takes a bit of time to answer. I think I spent 3 chapters of this book. So the very short answer is that from where you're standing in the middle of the organization, everybody is already in. And it looks like a flat mesa. You're either in at your level or you're not part of it. From the outside, though, there's a gradual, what I call an activation ladder. You start here, you hear about the organization, you hear about the mission, you get interested, you visit the website, you make contact with somebody, you maybe go have coffee with somebody. There's a very, very gradual ladder to climb in order to activate. And so the key insight here is that the organization can only grow on its edges. That means you must be pumping out the message all the time, again and again, from where you're sitting. Like ripples on the water, you must reach the edges on a cadence with this message, because that's the only place it can grow. And once it has grown, you need to reach new people with the same message all over again. Give them confidence to speak about the issues, give them clarity about the issues, and help them fulfill the mission, which was the reason they joined in the first place.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rick, for joining us. It seems like anyone have any more questions while we got them? No? Okay. Thank you very much for joining us. I really am hopeful that one day you'll be able to join us in person. And you know, if we accomplish our mission here, then we'll be able to keep pushing those edges out beyond New Hampshire to maybe the rest of the country and even the rest of the world. So thank you very much. I look forward to having you check in with us regularly, and I know that you and I have talked about trying to keep the conversation going.